My name is Karie Rego, and this is my daughter Marina, who was diagnosed with Kawasaki Disease, or KD, when she was almost 4 years old. When Marina was diagnosed, I had many questions about her treatment and the potential damage from the disease. Working together with the KD Foundation, we developed this presentation in consultation with some of the country's physician KD experts. Kawasaki disease can be successfully treated if diagnosed early. There is an effective treatment, and fortunately, heart damage can be prevented in most children. Kawasaki disease is not contagious, and a second episode of the disease or occurrence in siblings is rare. We had just come back from a car trip, and the following day, Marina developed a fever, and then later that day, a rash on her stomach. Because my son Darius has a heart defect and had surgery when he was 1 week old, I'm a little more concerned about fevers than other parents would be, so we went to the pediatrician the next day. He thought it was a virus and we went home. Her rash and fever worsened over the next couple of days and her hands and feet started to swell and turn red. We took her back to the pediatrician and on the evening of day 4, he began to suspect KD. Marina was admitted to the local hospital. She had an IV inserted, which we already knew with our son was usually traumatic and difficult because of their small veins and dehydrated state. Once the IV was in, labs were drawn. Marina was seen by the attending physician, a cardiologist, and an infectious disease specialist. The diagnosis of KD was made on day 5. It helped greatly that Marina had just started to have the other classic KD symptoms of a strawberry tongue and cracked lips, as well as red eyes. At this point, we're in a state of shock. The thought of having a second child with a heart problem was difficult to bear. After the shock wore off, we started to learn more about KD. Research suggests that KD has probably been around in the US and Western Europe for over 150 years, possibly being mistaken for other conditions. However, the disease was first named after a Japanese physician who became concerned at the number of children he was seeing in the mid-1960s with unexplained fevers that were resistant to usual antibiotics. Now that KD is an identified disease in Japan, there are over 10,000 cases each year. In the United States, it's estimated that the figure is between 4,000 and 5,000 children each year. Theories abound as to what causes KD. The current theory is that children may be born with a genetic predisposition to KD, and if they encounter the environmental trigger, they can develop into a full-blown syndrome. What the trigger is remains a mystery. It is likely to be a virus or some as yet unknown infectious agent. Because KD is a newly recognized condition, not all healthcare providers are familiar with it, and diagnosis may be delayed. KD can mimic other infections or allergic conditions that do not require hospitalization.
In my 20 years of seeing patients here at Rady Children's Hospital in San Diego, the most common reason that children have a misdiagnosis or a delayed diagnosis is that the signs and symptoms may come and go, or they're simply not all there at a single point in time. Incomplete Kawasaki disease can be a real problem because it leads to delay in diagnosis, and that means that the inflammation continues and the coronary arteries may be damaged. In young babies, particularly babies under 6 months of age, the signs may be very subtle, and those children are often missed. And that also applies to teenagers, where people simply don't think of the diagnosis.
Let's take a look at what we believe happens. The coronary arteries are the blood vessels that supply oxygen to the heart muscle. Because the heart muscle is always contracting, it needs a steady flow of blood to bring it nutrition and oxygen. When children develop Kawasaki disease, the walls of the arteries become inflamed. If we go inside the blood vessels, we might see something like this. Normally, a cell layer called the endothelium protects the vessel wall and prevents blood cells from leaving. However, some trigger during the development of Kawasaki disease causes the endothelial cells to become activated and causes cells of the immune system to stick to the endothelium and leave through the blood vessel wall. Inflammation in the vessel wall is caused by immune cells gathering in the wall and liberating chemical signals that recruit more cells and further damage the vessel wall. Intravenous gamma globulin, or IVIG, interacts with these cells to quiet down the immune response, although the exact mechanisms of how this is achieved are poorly understood. When inflammation occurs in the vessel wall, it also causes the artery to dilate. About one-third of children in the early stage of Kawasaki disease will experience dilated or widened coronary arteries. If the patient is treated with a protein solution called gamma globulin, or IVIG, within the first 10 days after fever onset, the chances of a dilated artery returning to normal size without scarring is excellent. However, if the inflammation is treated late or the IVIG infusion is not effective, permanent damage can occur to the arterial wall. Sometimes this results in a ballooning out of the wall called an aneurysm. This ballooning of the vessel causes blood to swirl and increases the risk of blood clot formation, which can be prevented with low-dose aspirin and other medications. If the blood clot continues to grow, this may result in blockage of the vessel and a heart attack. In many cases, scar tissue will begin to form in the aneurysm over time and the blood vessel will heal. However, the blood vessel is never again completely normal, and many years after Kawasaki disease, scarring could lead to narrowing of the vessel and again present a risk for heart attack.
Your child will be treated with an intravenous solution of gamma globulin, or IVIG. The infusion usually takes 10 to 12 hours. In addition, your child will receive a high dose of aspirin. Following the treatment with IVIG, your child's temperature will usually return to normal within the first 24 hours. However, in some parts of the United States, up to 20% of children may have recurrent fever and need additional medication. Research is ongoing in many centers across the United States to find other treatments for these children.
Right before the IVIG started, Marina was at her sickest. After the treatment, she improved significantly and the rash and swelling just disappeared.
I've been taking care of patients and doing research in KD for about 10 years now. And I think it's very important for parents to remember that in the current age, with appropriate IVIG treatment, most patients won't have any coronary artery involvement. While in the hospital, your child will have an electrocardiogram to take a look at the heart rhythm, and also an echocardiogram, which uses sound waves to look at the heart's function and evaluate the condition of their coronary arteries. If your child is very young, the doctors may need to give sedation to help your child remain still during the echocardiogram. Measurement of the internal diameter of the coronary arteries will be compared to normal standards to determine if the arteries are dilated, which happens with some children with Kawasaki disease. Parents should ask the cardiologist or Kawasaki disease doctor to explain the measurements of coronary arteries in their child.
The American Heart Association has guidelines about the proper management and care of Kawasaki disease patients, and these guidelines are available at the KD Foundation website. The Heart Association recommends that an echocardiogram be done during the phase in the hospital when the child has fever and is first diagnosed, and then again during the recovery phase and 6 to 12 months later. Following discharge from the hospital, you need to observe your child for signs of fever. If you document fever, then you need to call your doctor immediately. Your child will probably be sent home on low-dose aspirin. This may be one half tablet or a whole tablet of baby aspirin. While your child is taking the aspirin, you may notice that the skin bruises more easily. This will stop once the aspirin therapy is discontinued.
A few hours after the treatment, Marina did have some nausea, and her fever initially disappeared and then reappeared about 12 hours after the treatment. We were concerned that the treatment didn't work, and we brought her back into the hospital. But after 24 hours, the fever was gone and she was looking much better. Before we were discharged, an echocardiogram was done.
After your child comes home from the hospital, you may notice that they do not have their normal level of energy. This should slowly resolve over the first month after discharge from the hospital. Children may also have joint complaints and stiffness. If these become severe, you should certainly contact your doctor. Another feature that you will notice is that many children have peeling of the fingertips and toes after Kawasaki disease. This is a normal part of the recovery phase and should not cause concern. IVIG can also interfere with some immunizations, and your child should not receive the measles vaccine, also called MMR, or the chickenpox vaccine for up to 1 year following administration of IVIG.
The long-term outcomes for children with no coronary artery involvement, that's currently being researched. It is possible that having KD earlier in life can lead to some heart problems later on in life, but just which children are going to grow up to have these problems, that's not currently known.
Marina, like most children whose KD was recognized and treated during the first 10 days of fever, had a great outcome. She seemed to return to her old self right away, except for being a little clingy as the result of the hospital stay. On her 6 week and then her 6 month echocardiograms, there was no evidence of damage to her heart.
It is recommended that even children with no coronary artery involvement continue to follow up with a cardiologist every 3 to 5 years. For children who have had aneurysms, care is more individualized.
I think it's important to recognize as a parent that not all physicians may have the same treatment recommendations regarding KD. You can discuss with them the AHA guidelines and the other information available on the KD Foundation website. It is also important following the disease to stay involved and informed as to the latest research on the long-term outcomes of KD.
Given the potential increased risk for cardiovascular disease, we adopted a heart-healthy diet and regular exercise for Marina.
There is much information available on the internet on heart-healthy foods for adults that might be useful. It may be challenging to change a small child's diet, but we did so in small steps, and it was helpful for the whole family to be healthier.
Research into Kawasaki disease is ongoing across the United States and internationally. Researchers are trying to answer questions like, why did your child get Kawasaki disease? How can we better treat it? How can we prevent it? What are the causes? These are questions that can only be answered through collaborative research efforts. We urge you to get involved, to support these research efforts, to educate your family and friends about Kawasaki disease.
We wish you and your child a speedy recovery. If you have any further questions, please contact the Kawasaki Disease Foundation Bridges Program. The Bridges Program is a network of volunteers available to provide support.